still see the steeple, little church on the hill. There's a line at the altar, and every pew had been filled. I remember the water, the choir singing old hymns. There was a peace in the valley. Oh, as the preacher man he said, in the name of the Father, the name of the Son, the name of the Spirit, you're washed by the blood and buried with Christ. Raised in new life, baptized. I can still hear the sermon. All the people said amen. It was a gift of salvation.
Check.
Well, hey, this is great. Isn't it great to be back at the banquet? Man, how about it? Enough of this COVID stuff, right? It's time to get back to life. And it is really good. This is like breathing fresh air just to see you folks again and getting things back to normal. We've got a fabulous dinner waiting for you, and this is just the hors d'oeuvres right here, man. We've got some stuff ready for you that you're going to love. Bear Man's coming up tonight. And, of course, we've got Ebel's to feed you. That's good stuff. So I have known at least one of the Borkovich guys for quite a while. Mike Borkovich used to be here all the time, representing the Department of Natural Resources. Now he's representing Leland County Sheriff's Department. Mike, thank you for being with us tonight. And his brother, who I think, if I'm not mistaken, actually served longer, maybe I'm wrong, Mike, not, close to it, in the Department of Natural Resources, and is also sheriff for the, or law enforcement official for Ferris State University, and has a lot of stories. In fact, so many stories, he had to put them in a book. And we're going to give one of those books away tonight. Bruce Borkovich is with us tonight. Give him a long hand here right now. Come on up here, Bruce. Thank you so much for helping us out. This is going to be very interesting.
Thank you. Appreciate it. Appreciate the introduction. So we have kind of a unique story. There were three Borkovich boys in Michigan who were all game wardens, conservation officers at the same time. And back in the late 80s, I was the last one hired. Lansing did some checking, and to the best of their ability, they were able to determine it's the only time in the United States, in any state, that they've had three brothers active at the same time. They've had father, sons, father, daughter, father, son, daughter, two brothers, brother, sister. But to have three brothers active at the same time was pretty unique, especially at that time in Michigan's history. So I'm going to just kind of introduce myself. I'm going to tell some game warden stories. Everyone loves game warden stories. I'm not going to tell the blood and guts and the gore and dead bodies. That isn't what I typically talk about. That isn't what's in the book. It's a lot of funny stuff. It's a lot of crazy stuff. A lot of stuff that'll make you shake your head. A lot of material that'll make you wonder how bright I am, and that's okay if you question that. I question that all the time. And then what I hope to do, I've got about a half an hour tops, and I hope to maybe the last 5 minutes, they're going to give me a 5 minute cue to answer any questions that you might have. So just a brief history. Brothers and I, we all grew up in the suburbs of Flint, Michigan, and grew up, we're very avid sportsmen even at a very young age. Professionally, interestingly enough, all three of us wanted to be game wardens out of high school. And remember, we're talking about sometime between the mid-70s, 75, 76, and there through the early 80s. And because of affirmative action rules in Michigan, white males weren't allowed to take a civil service test. If that's not politically correct, so be it. It's a fact. I talk about it. It's part of the history. And so, you know, all three of us altered our employment plans. Mike, who's the people's sheriff here in Leelanau County, Mike kind of dug in, kind of worked his, didn't give up, started with Parks Division, and he was the first one hired. And then eventually they relaxed the rules where at least white males were able to take the civil service test, and later we did that. So out of college, John and I, the other CO, did other things. I already have met one person from Everett, Michigan. Anyone else from Everett here tonight? It's usually not. But I started my career as a teacher and a coach in Everett. I was there for 4 years from 82 through 86, and finally was able to take the civil service test and become a game warden. And so when I was 27 years old or so, I switched gears and began to live our dream. My first exposure to a game warden was probably in the late 60s. Holloway Reservoir, there was an old-timer, famous game warden, Ivan Keston. And I remember him coming up to check us, and I was a kid, and I was just he was larger in life. And I remember, Mike, I'm sure you remember, he had a pearl-handled revolver. Not probably kosher with the department, but it really didn't matter. And I couldn't even make eye contact with him. He was such a legend. And it made quite an impression on me. And Mike and John and I spent our summers in Greenbush, Michigan, over on Lake Huron. My second exposure to a game warden was when we were snake hunting. So US 23 runs up and down the shoreline, and we grabbed our 22s, loaded them up, and we're kids. When I say kids, we're not six, but we're probably 8 and 10 and 12. And in the summertime, when the grasshoppers were really hatching, the snakes were everywhere, gorging themselves on grasshoppers. And so we were practicing our stealth skills and our marksmanship by shooting snakes in the head. And we were so engrossed in what we were doing that suddenly we hear gravel cracking and look back, and it's a green car with a blue light on it. It's a game warden. And we were raised in a very traditional family, taught to respect authority, and, you know, game wardens were the top of the heap. They were larger than life. And up comes the game warden. What are you boys doing? And of course, typical, there's sure not going to be a lie. It was shooting snakes, sir. So I think Mike, he was the oldest brother, shooting snakes, sir. And I remember this game warden went into this. Of course, I couldn't take, what am I looking at? His gun, right, as a kid. This is Wyatt Earp and Doc Holliday and everyone all rolled into one. And I'm just staring. And he gave us this wonderful lecture about how snakes are part of the ecosystem and they're important and they do this and they do that. And where do you boys, where's your cottage? I think you boys should unload your guns and go home. Now, that was an old school game warden. He could have made life miserable on us, probably could have written my dad a ticket, but I think he saw three nice, respectful, clean-cut kids out doing probably what he would do. Well, it wasn't until 30, 40 years later, at his retirement party, that I went to and talked about the story and found out Wayne hated snakes more than anything you can ever imagine. And he remembered the story, and he says it was everything he could do not to pay us for what we were doing, to kill every snake up and down the road. He hated snakes, but he had to do his job. So you know, that impression was made on us, and it was a dream for us. And so in 1986, became a conservation officer, a game warden. In 99, I became a detective with the DNR. There were two detectives for the state. I had the whole lower peninsula, and Mike Johnson had the whole upper peninsula. And we did all of the department's major investigations, commercialization of wildlife, and then we did the department's undercover work. And at that time, we did what's called deep cover work, where we actually lived sometimes with these people. I had a complete false identity, including a false a working Social Security number. I had credit history and working credit cards and the whole nine yards. And again, we'll talk about a couple of those cases that I ran, but we go into more detail in the book if anyone's interested later. So I retired in 2006 on a Friday. The following Monday, I went to work as a detective and the assistant team leader for the Bayonet Drug Team. That's a state police-run drug team in the Mount Pleasant, Clark County area. And I helped run that team for 7 years, from 2006 through 2013. And then it was time, age-wise and body-wise, to quit kicking doors down, try something different. So I became, any Fair State Bulldogs in here? Got a couple dogs in here, good, nice, I like it. Something happened this year for Ferris? Anything good? People, please, what's that? They won the National Football Championship. People, please. That was a pretty big deal. And so in 13, I became the police chief at Ferris. And I did that until November of 2020, I retired. And then actually, of all things, I was a volunteer assistant football coach this year. I helped coach a football team. I think it's because of me that we went to the national title. I'm pretty sure it was. And I'm not a football guy. We were all basketball guys, but we had a good run. So that's kind of my history. That's how I started and how I ended. And just gonna kind of highlight some stories, some things, odd things, strange things I ran into over the years. We'll go back a little bit and what helped form us. My dad was a wonderful, wonderful man, a wonderful sportsman and conservationist, always taught us lessons about, you know, wildlife management and laws and rules. And I remember my dad explaining, because I couldn't figure out, why are the skycarp protected? Anyone know what a skycarp is? Seagull, right? Why are they protected? They're everywhere. They're sky rats, we used to call them. And Dad explained it. It's old federal laws based on mariners' laws. If you're lost at sea, a seagull, you could possibly catch it, eat it, and live. Seagulls might help guide you to land. And so they were protected, federally protected, and we knew that. So back then, you could drop your kids off anywhere for the day and they'd be safe, just a different time. So Dad dropped the three of us off at the mouth of the Osabo River, and we're catching yellow-belly perch like you wouldn't believe, jumbo yellow-belly perch, it's amazing. And we've got them on a stringer, and they're sitting there floating along the rocks there, the riprap and the boulders, and I look, and there's a seagull over there pecking at them. Now, if you've never had a Great Lakes yellow-belly perch, it's hard to understand how good they are. I mean, it was a treasure. And I just couldn't believe it. And I'm not exaggerating when I say it was probably from here to the exit doors, not this door, going outside. And I'm the youngest brother. I pick up a rock about that big to throw it, to splash the water to scare the seagull. Can anyone possibly guess what happened? What do you think happened? I missed? What do you think happened? I hit it in the head, and it just went over and died. It was incredible. I could have picked up another 1,000 stones and thrown and never hit that seagull, but I hit it in the head and it died. And of course, for the young guys in here, you don't understand what it was like being a younger brother back in the 60s, early 70s. It was brutal. It was wonderful because it made me so tough, But it was brutal. Well, my brothers aren't going to waste this opportunity. And I can still remember, oh, man, look what you did. Dad's going to prison. Oh, and we idolized my father. He was the most wonderful man in the world. I was crushed at the thought that I did something that might send my dad to prison. And then, older brothers, let's make a deal. And I don't know how many times I had to polish their bikes. We all had old Schwinn bikes with the chrome all over. Cut all these deals so that they didn't turn me in. And of course, I never got in trouble. Dad never went to prison. But, scared to death. Helped make me the game warden that I was today. There was another little incident, and I am getting to game warden stories, I promise, but there was another little incident. Across US 23, there's a huge swamp, and I just loved creepy crawly things, snakes and salamanders. Well, every species of salamander in Michigan was out in that cedar swamp. I sneak over one day, go across there, and I hit the mother load of salamanders. I'm in shorts, I don't know, I'm 8 years old, wandering around a cedar swamp alone, no one knows where I'm at. And I catch him, I come back, and my mom looks at me, and I am covered in mosquito bites and blood. 81 mosquito bites, they counted them. Brothers are just sitting there, shaking their head, wondering, you know, this guy might not make it. You know, he might not make it in the world. And but that's the kind of obsessive outdoorsmen we were. And those, actually, some of those habits and that perseverance is what made us pretty effective. Hired in 86, graduated from the police academy November 14th. Is that significant to anyone? Imagine a game warden November 14th, and here was the training program back then. Go to your car, guns, uniforms, stuff in there, a map of Michigan, a county is circled where you're assigned, a law book and a stack of ticket books, and go work tomorrow's opening day of deer season. So graduated on the 14th, out I go, had no clue what I was doing, but kind of figured it out as I went. I was assigned in Mount Pleasant, Isabella County, and I was relentless. I had a lot more go than I had brains. And I'm trying to learn this county, and I realized we've got a lake that has a pretty good walleye population. There's a river that runs through it, as most of you probably know, that helps natural reproduction in an inland lake. And I'd heard that, and this is very, very early April, first couple days of April, but it has been a cold, rough winter. In this cold water river that runs into cold water lake, snakes in the mouth of it, and I was sneaking and looking, and I see about 20 guys at the mouth of that river. Walleye season's not open, and they're all there, and I'm convinced they're all there snagging walleyes, because there hadn't been a game warden in that county for 2 years, and I think they were just used to, getting away with things. So I'm trying to figure out how to do it. There's only one way to get to them, and that's come up the river. How many people have ever fished, trapped, been on a river? Anyone? Do they go in straight lines from here to there? No. I took off in the afternoon, freezing. Half of the river was ice, and the middle channel was open. No waders. About crotch deep. I won't go into further details than that. And I'm wading up, and it's this, back and forth and back and forth, and I'm getting colder, and the sun's going down more. I finally can see people, and I'm trying to make my approach, and I kind of hop out there, and I shout out, I better not see one fish get dumped, because I was looking, and I could see fish on stringers, and I thought, oh, I'm going to make the best case a game warden's ever made, and everyone's just staring at me, and so the first group I come to is an older guy and his grandson. No one's saying a word, not, and I thought, wow, these people expect someone to be running or dumping or fighting or threatening or something. Everyone's just staring at me. And I get closer and closer, and I look, they got a stringer full of fish. Beautiful. Stringer full of suckers. The suckers are running. And everyone had a stringer full of suckers. And if you don't know, they're not protected. You take as many as you want, anytime you want. So now I got to kind of play it cool, like I know what I'm doing. And finally, the old guy, I'm checking license, and he finally says, water's kind of cold, isn't it? I said, yes, sir, it is. I check the rest of the license, and off I go right back up the river, and it was dark, I have never been so cold in my life. I think the embarrassment kept me from freezing to death. But that's how you learn in that business. Sometimes you end up with more go than you do brains. Had another interesting case. Got a call, a 911 call, about a crazy turkey that's attacking this lady. And I'm thinking, I know who's crazy here. We got a crazy lady. It's in the springtime. Got a crazy lady. So I'm going to go take care of it. And I pull into the driveway, and I look, and over in the yard is a really big Tom. Big Tom. And he's just looking at me. And I go to the door, and it's a young mother with two little kids, toddlers, and then a baby. She's got to get a kid to a doctor's appointment, and she's in tears. I said, what's going on? Every time she tries to leave the house, that turkey's attacking her. And by this time, I look, and he's, from me to you away, he's coming right after me. And I finally realize that it does happen sometimes. Some of the toms get really, really aggressive. Now I'm thinking, well, I've got to do something with this bird, or else we're going to get calls forever. And so there's kind of a little neighborhood around a lake. So I lure him out. I'm mouthing at him and talking to him like big time wrestling, you know. And I finally get him out in the woods. And everyone knows who Tanya Harding is, right? The skater. And everyone knows that she hit Nancy Kerrigan with a steel pipe. Well, it's a baton. We actually called those. We used to carry them. It's a collapsible baton. We called them batanias to commemorate that wonderful event in Nancy Kerrigan's life. And I lured him out. I didn't want to shoot him, and I lured him out, and he came at me, and I whacked him in the head, and that was over with. But that's just some of the crazy calls we get. Sometimes you think this lady's nuts or someone's not telling the truth. No, this turkey was attacking her and wouldn't let her out of the house. I remember the first undercover case we did. Back then, the uniform officers could get authorization to go do short-term undercover work. And some officers in Lake County, where Baldwin is, requested some fresh faces because they had some complaints of some guys, a lot of guys poaching salmon and selling them. And so another good friend and I went over there and worked it. And we got a little bit of a bloated ego on how successful we were. Some of these people weren't real bright. Matter of fact, one guy, the local cops nicknamed him Sanitary Sam because his mouth was so infected. It looked like he'd been flossing his teeth with a chainsaw. He just unbelievable. I didn't want to be within 10 feet of him. And so we end up getting into these people. We made some really good cases. They're snagging salmon. The main target, though, we got into, and it was a guy that was snagging a lot of salmon and selling them. You can't sell fish and game. And so as we are making our introductions to this guy to try and, we told him we worked in an auto shop and we were selling the salmon in the shop, and it worked. We went into his house, into his trailer, and his wife was in there. And he's all gung-ho because he can smell the money on us, and she's just sitting back. And I'm telling you, if you've done law enforcement and undercover work, you'll realize guys are really simple, and the instincts that females have are much harder. It's much harder to fool and infiltrate a female than males. She's just sitting back there staring at us. And, of course, Jimmy, the guy we're working, he's gung-ho, let's go get it, I need money. And finally she says, I got to ask you something. Are you a game warden? And we're laughing, you know, we've got our pet answers we give about that. And she still wasn't very comfortable. So a couple days, we work them for a couple days, we buy a bunch of fish. We go back with Mitch Babcock, was the uniform sergeant back then. Cool, cool guy over in Nuevo County. And he's going to go over with us and bust this guy and take him to jail. And we knock on the door, and he comes to the door, and there's the two undercover guys, and then Mitch is in uniform, and we get this guy out and get him handcuffed, and she is livid. She sees me, and she's red in the face, and she comes out, and she says, two times I asked him if he was a game warden, and he said no. And Mitch always had a toothpick in his mouth, and he goes, I guess I'll have to talk to him about that, won't I? That was it. So that was my introduction into undercover work, and I liked it. And that really kind of whet my appetite for what I did later. Another guy and I also had the honors of making the first arrest that we know of in the state of Michigan for prostitution. We're working down the Crow Island State Game Area. Mike used to be assigned down there. And believe it or not, this is back when there were pheasants, and there was an area where people dumped garbage. I know this sounds weird, but the pheasants would come and pick through the garbage, and the road hunters would go by and shoot them. So we're in that area working, and we're in a pickup truck with a canoe on top, so it doesn't really look like we're game wardens. We got camouflage coats on, and we buzz up there, and there's a car there, and we thought it was one person. They see us, and it's two people, and it's a guy and a girl, and we're trying to figure it out. We get them out of the vehicles, and she gets out of the car. She's got a crack pipe that's still smoking in one hand. She's got a bottle of black velvet in the other hand. Her pants are at her ankles, and the first words out of her mouth, "How come you ain't out arresting real criminals?" I swear to God. So we turns out this guy's married, three kids, drunk, a wife and three kids, drunk. We didn't have, because of all the stuff we had in the truck, we didn't have room to transport her and him to jail, so we called a sheriff's deputy out. He came out and said, "Well, that's Charlotte," I think I can say her name because I think she's no longer, doesn't matter the last name, "that's Charlotte such and such. She's the most, you know, notorious prostitute that we have, and she's got AIDS." And so the end of the story, I kind of felt sorry for his wife until I find out a couple weeks later, he gets a letter in the mail. In many court systems in Saginaw County, if you get arrested for a sex crime, mandatory blood test for STDs. So they send a letter to his house saying, "Hey, based on you soliciting, being arrested for the crime of soliciting prostitution, you have to go get a blood test." Well, he told his wife he just got arrested for drunk driving. She comes in, he tells her, "We're making it all up, we're lying." She comes in, files a complaint to the lieutenant Usher. So I didn't feel quite so sorry for her, but I did feel sorry for the kids. But so we went on record as making the first arrest for prostitution by a game warden that we know of in the state of Michigan. We're gonna kind of, because I'm limited time-wise here, a couple undercover cases that I was able to run that turned out fantastic. One we named because it was a long-term investigation, Operation Kerr. There was a group of guys up by Glennie and Alpena that were poaching and selling bobcats, bears, mostly bobcats, bears, badger, turkey. Toward the end, a guy wanted to kill a couple eagles and sell them to me, but I was undercover with them for 9 months. One time I spent 4 days living with them, and back then, our surveillance systems were very poor. There was no cell signal at the house. So I was there all on my own. I didn't have a surveillance team. One time a day, my cover was that I was a builder. One time a day, I'd leave the house because I had to go check in with the office, and I'd get to where a cell signal was and let my boss know that I'm alive and make a quick call to, what's her name, my wife. I know her name, it'll come to me, and let her know I was okay. But for 4 days, I went out, did everything they're doing, ate their food, slept in their place. The first night, the main suspect, who was really wary of me, comes out, sits at the table, and pulls a pistol out, a Glock pistol, and it's like half the distance from me to you at a table, and just staring at me while everyone else is talking. And I remember thinking I had a 5-shot revolver hidden on me, and I remember thinking, I can't even shoot my way out of this. There's about a dozen people here. They're all bad people except two kids, two teenagers. And I thought, I don't even have enough bullets to shoot my way out of this. But made a great case, a wonderful case, arrested. It culminated in one of the guys found a sow, bear, and three cubs hibernating, stuck a .22 in there, killed the sow and two cubs. One cub got away and then sold them to me for $650. And after that, we thought that's enough. So another case, undercover case that I got into, strange, strange case. We hadn't worked an investigation into the illegal trade of reptiles in almost forever. And we did one, very successful. It actually spread out to about 12 states. We did simultaneous search warrants on one day in 12 different states. I was undercover for 2 years with these people. going to shows with them, going out and to the bars with them and everything else. Strange, strange people. Some of these guys, like one guy, remember he had contacts that made his eyes look like a snake, vertical slits. He had metal rods put in his head. He had his tongue surgically cut so it was forked like a snake, and he could actually wiggle, articulate, both of them. But again, it still stands as the largest investigation into the illegal trade of reptiles in the country. So I had good fortune and good success doing that undercover work. I'm winding down, and I want to give a chance for a couple questions. In, as I said, 2006, I had the opportunity to retire. I'd had enough fun, probably done enough crazy, dangerous things, and between A and Z, here's where the plug for the book is. There's a ton more stories into a lot greater detail. So if you're interested, not only is my book going to be for sale here, it's called Wild Things, but Brother John also wrote a book, excellent book. It's called Wildlife 911, Game Warden also. Fantastic cop, made fantastic cases. And his book is for sale there too. They're $20 if anyone's interested. And with that, I think I've only got a couple minutes. How about like maybe three questions if there are any? Yes. Yeah, it's a great question. Unfortunately, most of these things are misdemeanors. Most of the wildlife laws are misdemeanors. And I was crushed up in that particular county, Alcona County, where I ran Operation Kerr with the bears and bobcats, because the judge chose, if you get one guy had like $40,000 in fines, and the judge, and he wasn't gonna pay him. And what the judge is supposed to do is put him in jail for $10 a day. So your fines are paid off. Judge said, oh, that's unfair, he doesn't have the money. And the judge kind of let these guys off with a slap on the wrist. And so what you learn in law enforcement, Mike, I'm sure, teaches his deputies the same thing. Do your job, be a professional, make the cases, let the courts do what they do, because you can't control what's gonna happen. You do your job, bring a good case forward, and you can't control what happens. So it varies is the best answer. Yes, sir.
When I was a kid in Genesee County.
Ivan Keston did? Holy buckets. Did he have a pearl handle revolver, do you remember?
Oh, yeah.
So that's going way back. Where did you live in Flint?
I was in Clio.
Oh, yeah. Excellent. One more question. Anyone? How about back?
Are you better shot than your brother Mike?
I am not. I would say I'm the second best out of the three. We're all good shots. Mike's the best shot. I was a good shot. I was top gun in my academy, but Mike was a better shot than we were. So.
Hey, give him a round of applause, folks.
Thank you.
And if you have a question, I'm sure you'll be able to catch Mike after the dinner time and or maybe catch him in the hallway. I don't know. He'll be here. Why don't you hold on to these for me, Mike? Bruce, excuse me. I'm too used to Mike. I'm sorry. I just met you for the first time today. All right, so we have his book as well as a Rapala fishing knife. And so we picked out randomly, I might add, ticket number 403111.
What color ticket?
Pink. Excuse me. I didn't know there were other colors. 403111. Got a winner over here.
Anyone?
Come on up
all
here.
All right.
Okay, for the that was for the knife.
Knife.
And here's for the book. 403065. 403065. Okay.
Hey, one more plug. This book was very intentionally written with nothing inappropriate. Every kid sitting at that in that row, this is appropriate. No swear words, no sex.
Good.
I did that intentionally, and I can tell you, young adults, young men and women who love the outdoors are loving this book. So please share it with a youngster if you can. They really enjoy it.
Give them a round of applause one more time, and then please exit to this side over here, please. Everybody move over that way and go on down to the dinner time, okay? Go on down that way. Thank you.